Lucio, welcome. Good to have you. He's the first one to get a chair even before he opens his mouth. So, welcome, Lucio.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I hope you all had your cup of coffee. Otherwise, I hope you will consider my presentation as a wake-up call. Two preliminary remarks. First, time is not on our side. 2030 is fast approaching. Secondly, we are all swimming against the tide, at least the people in this room, because the cultural and political mood in Europe and elsewhere is based and is inclined more to competition than to cooperation. And if we lack a common, a global approach to those issues, we are wasting our time. I will concentrate first on the essential push factors of migrations, and then end my presentation with a couple of concrete proposals of how to manage the nexus between food and migrations. Push factors which, of course, feed into each other and produce huge migration flows, especially from Northern Africa to Europe through the Mediterranean, if it works. Yes. The first issue is the climate change, of course. And here you see a couple of maps which are published in our report, which we did a couple of months ago in cooperation BCFN and Macrogeo. You see the warming of this region, and by the way, not only of this region, which affects, as we know, as we experience every day, also our countries. And the consequences, by the way, are especially those who which are of grave interest to us, affect the water scarcity and the drying of the soil. Consider that by a warming of temperature of about 0.7 Celsius degrees within the next decades, the desertification also of parts of Southern Europe, including Italy, will become really impressive and really also a socio-political problem. And as far as the other part of the Mediterranean is concerned, it was calculated that by 2030, if we do not do anything, we will have about 200 million Africans who live in areas with a high water scarcity and high water stress, which means that agriculture will be impossible in those areas. I think that desertification, in fact, represents probably the single biggest environmental threat of our times, affecting agriculture, especially the four crops which are mentioned here. And we should consider that 50% of food is produced through those crops. So probably one of the things which should change in the future, and in the near future, I hope, is that we will have more crops for a variety of crops for producing food. Desertification, I will stay on that. Of course, it's not a new problem. We had it also in the, for example, in the 15th century and in other areas of the world. But today, the Earth's intertropical area is characterized by the greatest concentration of desertification phenomena, starting with the immense deforestation that alters radically the existing environmental frameworks. We have to consider that according to the United Nations, about 25% of the world's cultivated land and 70% of arid arable land is affected by desertification, endangering the livelihoods of more than 1 billion people, particularly farmers and shepherds in about 100 countries. In sub-Saharan Africa, for example, about 265 million people are affected by the consequences of desertification, which means with clearly food shortages and intensification of exploitation levels, which bring about a drastic limitation of the regenerative practice of the fallow. For most African farmers, fallow periods have fallen from 15 years during the 1970s to around 10 years in the 1980s, to just 5 years in the 1990s, and to about 2 years now. So you see the impact of the changing climate, of the changing environment in Africa and other parts of the world. And this is one of the major push factor of migration, but certainly not the only one. The other dramatic issue we have to tackle is overpopulation. The demographic increase in Africa, or to put it otherwise, the lack of demographic transition in Africa, as we had, for example, in Europe. You see the differences between the expectation of life and of the median age between meaning Central Europe, Western Europe, Mediterranean Europe, and African areas, especially Western Africa, and more specifically Nigeria, where the median age is of about 18. And Nigeria is, or was last year, probably the most important migration hub in Africa. So if we consider that probably in the next future, I mean by the mid of the century, the African population will double from 1 billion and 200 million to 2 billion and 400 million, and we will be less than we are now, we Europeans, from 700 million, including Russians and Ukrainians, to 600 million, you will see that the difference will be biological, because we are aged, and also a quantitative difference, which will be increasing, and probably increasing even more in the second half of the century. And then we have to consider this picture, which is a kind of impact of geopolitical factors to the migration issue and also to agriculture. Just consider what we call chaos land, so this area in which you find most vulnerable areas of the world, where you have most conflicts, instability, and those areas correspond more or less with the less cultivated areas of the world. So there is clearly a nexus between agriculture, migration, and conflict. This is a push factor in which we have, of course, also a responsibility, considering also military intervention by European countries in some areas of Africa and the Middle East, which normally didn't bring about any peaceful solution. So if we consider all this together, we see that this some kind of cooperation between instability and agricultural problems will bring about serious problems in terms of food shortage, etc. Here you have a map of fragile states. Again, you see that the states which I mentioned before, especially in Africa, are increasingly unsustainable or failing or even non-existent. And here the major migratory routes. By the way, the routes of migrations are historically the routes of any kind of traffics and of food. Problem is that now we have policies of tight control of the borders, for example, between Turkey and Greece, less tight but still working between Morocco and Spain, and the most relevant flow of migrants comes from Western Africa, Eastern Africa, through Libya or through Niger and Libya to Italy, especially to Sicily, but also to Sardinia and other parts of southern Italy. And then there is a problem of having a common approach to migration, which is not the case because you see that Schengen is de facto suspended in many countries and that each country tends to unload the problem to the neighbor. And this is certainly not any kind of solution to the problem, but it is a serious problem for example, Italy and other European countries like Greece. And it already affects the cultural and political mood in our countries. Let me just conclude with some practical proposals of how to tackle this nexus between food, ecology, and migration. First of all, we have to reduce the conflicts and instability, because if we don't do that, we are not able to help the people on the ground and they can't help themselves. This is, of course, a highly difficult task, but we have no choice. Second and very important is opening the doors of Europe to the products coming from the south, from Africa, which means lowering the trade barriers and increasing the free trade in the Euro-Mediterranean area, which is an old European idea which still has to be, in some sense, produced. Second point, or third point, is energy. 600 million people in Africa don't have any kind of web connection, and some more people don't have any electricity. So a majority of people in the African continent still has a serious problem of energy. I think that developing energy projects, especially as far as solar energy is concerned and all kind of renewables, should be a priority. And it becomes, from time to time, I would say, easier in terms of technology, because we now have technologies which permit some sense of bottom-up processes, which may be available for people on the ground. Fourth, urgent aid is needed in case of emergencies, but we should not overestimate aid, because it's a fact that the countries which receive less international aid perform better than those which receive one, which should be probably a reflection which we should do. Connected to that, the issue of remittances, because the main product in terms of economy of the migrations, as far as the African countries are concerned, are remittances. Let's consider that between 2015 and 2030, about $6.5 trillion, I repeat, $6.5 trillion, will be sent by migrants to low and middle income countries. So there is no proportion between those quantities with any kind of international aid or help. So remittances, which means migrations, because you need migrants to get remittances home, are essential for the increase the income of families, achieve better health and nutrition. Migrants send money home when situations are really tough. So remittances are, in some sense, more flexible than normal international aid or also national policies. But we need schemes. We need schemes addressed to developing agriculture and sustainable agri-food supply chains through remittances, using that money in a sensible way. Then again, as I said before, we need diversification of crops, which is possible also through new technologies, because we know that we are facing more food demand, but with less food production on the ground in Africa, which means that there will be more food imports by African countries, by African people in the next future, which will cost more and will, of course, bring about more suffering. Today, Africa imports food for about $35 billion every year. By 2025, the amount of food import will be of about $110 billion. So you see, the inertia is not on our side. And last but not least, education, culture, which means that we have to be there and we have to exchange our views and our perceptions and also our studies. I think that universities and private institutions should play a major role in this area, especially as far as women are concerned, because one of the main drivers of the, let's put it this way, lack of demographic transition, also democratic, but demographic transition in Africa is the fact that women there are not empowered as they should be, with some exception, of course, but the global picture in this sense is not really the best possible one. And if we don't manage to reduce the population growth, which means that we will have to have less people which are losing their jobs or are not able to do something sensible, we will experience more crises, more migrations, and maybe more conflicts, because the reaction which is now typical in some European countries is not enhancing our hopes as far as the solving of the problems of food and migration are concerned. Thank you so much.